rather than doing the same presentation over and over again, which I think is a lazy thing, because then you can just put it on YouTube and save everyone's time, I tried to figure out what would be appealing that would cause people to want to see me more than once, ideally. And I thought of Bruce Springsteen, where he basically does a lot of the same songs every night. So, Born to Run, like he's probably does it every single concert he's done. But at the same time, people still want to see him because he changes things up, and the same song will be different whether it's a large place or a small place, acoustic, electric, whatever. And so what I've tried to do, because if you look at TED Talks, basically in 18 minutes, you can tell an amazing amount of things. And most people talk for 45 minutes and leave about 15 minutes for questions. So I thought, why not take the TED idea and try to have a very short topic, say you talk for about 15 minutes, and then you take the rest of the time and you have it as interactive group Q&A.
Right.
Yeah. Because as a speaker, you don't learn anything unless you know what's in the audience's minds. I already have a pretty good sense of what I'm going to say. I don't have it all memorized, but doing that is no big deal. I could do that with an empty room and maybe add a soundtrack if I knew how. It would look like I was talking to thousands.
Yeah.
I think the real magic is when the group interacts as a whole. And so I don't think this particular one is 15 minutes. It'll probably be like half the time will be the presentation, half will be discussion. But I find that when I go to things, that's where I benefit the most, is when I hear from other people, the wisdom of crowds, etc.
So are we to assume that the rest of the people who came today don't want to learn how to earn trust?
That's right, yeah.
Well, it's what I find is that the right people tend to be at the right place. And so these are people who, it's not to say that you are not trustworthy, but are interested in learning more about the topic.
Okay.
In this session, let me pretend that I'm starting all over again. Now that everything's working. In this session, we'll be talking about how to earn and keep trust. And this is an advanced session, so we'll make the assumption that you can do the work and you will do the work. So you've got the will and you've got the skill, right? And so the challenges are probably more along the lines of getting clients to refer you and then getting new clients. And a big challenge in that process is trust. Now, trust is something that starts off looking true, but then what happens with neglect, you end up with rust. And after that, what's left for us? And what's left for our clients? Hey, that's meant to be serious.
That's awesome.
I like that. Because we like words.
Okay, yes, you're okay.
We like
for the
words.
Visual people, did that work too? The fact that it's the same word in different letters? I don't know. But trust is a big challenge for us and also for our clients. So the question that arises is, who do you trust? And this is a rhetorical question, so you don't have to actually answer this one. I'll give you some thoughts and then we'll get back to it. But as we go through this, you'll get a sense that maybe it's not so easy to trust people in general, and as a result, it's tougher for people to trust us. And we'll use examples from the world of tobacco advertising. There was a time when we trusted authority. And so when you had doctors saying that smoking Camels was good, then it suggested that not only was smoking good, this particular brand was a really good choice. But then this thing called throat cancer started becoming a concern, and so maybe this wasn't quite as persuasive. So we stopped listening to the doctors, and we started listening to celebrities. Now, John Wayne, he says that his voice is really important to him, and as a result, he smokes Camels. Now, he died of cancer later on in his life, but at the time, there was not even a single case of throat irritation from smoking. They didn't use the word cancer in those days, they just called it throat irritation, and this brand didn't cause any problems. And so, and then the fine print says that men think that he's great and women think he's great, and so, and women smoke, etc. So it seemed that, okay, smoking is probably good, these famous people are doing it. But then, as we know, he did die, and so I think in his last movie, which the name of which I forget, he had basically had oxygen near him so that he could breathe, which wasn't so good. And so we'd stop listening to celebrities, and then the advertisers tried using popularity. So statistically, this particular brand is smoked by more people than any other brand, and so it's the best, right? And you've got happy, smiling people just loving these cigarettes. Now, times have changed, and so when you look at Joe Camel has become Joe Chemo, and we don't listen to a lot of the things that we used to in the past. So today, if you look at things, we don't trust authority the way that we may have in the past. We don't trust celebrity. We don't trust popularity. And given all of that, the question that arises is, why would anyone trust you or me? Right? Because we've all seen situations where we have been harmed. And so when it comes to a client, they don't know if they're dealing with a joker or an ace. And in real life, there are a lot more jokers than aces. And we have to find ways to deal with those types of concerns that people have. Now, we'll dissect this because it's a little bit of a complicated thing to absorb first thing in the morning. But this is the motto of the Society of Actuaries. And the two key words in this are facts and demonstrations. And now, a fact is a verifiable truth. A demonstration is a display of proof. And we'll see that in trust, we require both of these elements. So it's not, because I go to a lot of places where I meet freelancers and everyone tells me how great they are at the work they do, but it's basically just them saying that. And what else would you expect them to say? Right? And so it's not very convincing. And in many cases, there are other people doing something similar to what we're doing. Now, we may feel that we are the very best, but from a client's point of view, it may be like Coke or Pepsi, that, okay, they may prefer one, but hey, if that brand's not there, they're not going to walk out. Or maybe even 7-Up would be good enough. And so trust is an element that helps in that process. So if you look at trust, then there, based on my years and years of extensive research, lab coats and all, I found that there were three elements. The first is chemistry. And so the question is, do they like you? And this is really based on first impressions, and so superficial things that shouldn't really matter, about how we dress and talk and these kinds of things. And it also depends on what they see when they look for us online, our digital tapestry. So these are unfair things, but these are things, like you would have a certain perception of me. I guess it's not so horrible that you walked out, but we have all these kinds of stereotypes and first impressions. So that's fine, but what can we do to get better at the chemistry part? Well, getting feedback is a really important thing. And this is a challenge for people, because if you look at Napoleon Hill, he described the six basic fears back 75 years ago in 1937. The biggest fear was poverty. Second to that was the fear of criticism. And criticism ties in with feedback. So the first thing is we have to be willing to accept feedback. Because if we're not willing to accept it, then it's very difficult to change. Then we need to ask people for feedback, and we need to find the right people to ask for that. And then we need to consider what they say, because what people tell us isn't necessarily right for us. For instance, we're talking earlier about, do you have a blog? And it may be good for some people, it may not be for others. And then the last part is to act, to actually do something. Otherwise, the feedback has just been wasted. A very good place to get feedback is going to be the next bullet, but let's deal with the one that's on the screen for the moment. It's also important to give feedback, because what happens is, if you look at people in general, we have really good ideas on how other people can fix up their lives, but we have this tendency to not tell them. And so there are things that we could tell them with good intentions, if they're open to feedback, that could actually help them, but we keep it to ourselves. So another part is to give feedback. And a really good place to do all of this is, I don't know if you've tried Toastmasters, but there, the whole process is built on feedback, where everything that's done in the meeting gets analyzed. You, not just speeches, but all sorts of other things. And it's also an opportunity to build leadership where you get to run meetings and do different things. So if you're looking for a place to deal with people where it's not necessarily just networking, this could be a support type of group. Now, with Toastmasters, the thing to keep in mind is that there are lots of clubs. I think there are over 250,000 clubs around the world. And each club has its own personality. You wouldn't want to judge Toastmasters by just visiting one club. You'd want to try a few to see which one might be a good fit for you. Another element in trust is credentials. And credentials relates to whether they think you can do the work. It doesn't mean whether you can or cannot do the work, but they have to think that you have the ability to do that. And that depends on things like your formal training. So in certain fields, there is actually a process you can go through where you can get some designations, etc. There's also practical experience. So you may have a lot of book knowledge, but maybe you haven't done much in real life. And then also, the world keeps changing, so are the skills current? Or are these things that are based on what we used to do in the past? In terms of building credentials, what we can do is show testimonials. So this shows that we were good in the past. There are people who are willing to go on the record and say nice things about us. And LinkedIn is a really good place for that. But that was then. We also need to show, and this is probably more important, we also need to show that we can do the work today. And for this, we need to show that our skills are current. And here, ongoing successes are a good way of demonstrating that, yes, we were good in the past, but you can see for yourself, because testimonials are a little suspect. If it was bad, then you would never post it. And you may have had, especially if you're a writer, you may have had to help the person craft it in a way that it conveyed what you wanted to say, etc. But it's really tough to fake displays of your current skills, right? Because people can just judge that for themselves. And then the third element is congruence. So this is basically, do you do what you say? Do you make promises? Do you keep promises? And this is the tricky one, because we have so many ways of telling whether people are doing what they say. In the past, we basically just had to rely on them, but now we have Google, we can actually do searches. And if someone says they're really amazing, we can check that out. Just for something to do last night, I was looking up the speakers today, and I thought the metric I would look at is how many Twitter followers they have relative to how many people they follow, right? Because if someone is an authority, then there should be more people following them than they follow. So maybe they follow 100 people and they have, well, I was going to say 1 million people, but I know that's too outlandish, but maybe they have 500 people following them. Now that would show that people are using their services. And what I saw, and you can check it out for yourself, that in the majority of cases, the speakers here today, and I think in general, had fewer people following them than they were following. So I think one of them had 10,000 followers, but it was based on following 11,000 people. Right, so 10,000 is impressive, but not if you basically have to follow more than that. It would be much more impressive to maybe be following 50 people and having 100 people follow. And so online we can verify whether things that people are telling us are actually correct. So if you look at congruence, these are some of the things that you can do. Demonstration is important, and so you can display proof of what you were able to do in the past, what you're doing now, and then give a sense of what you'll be able to do in the future, because what people are really hiring you for is what you will do for them, which is something that may never have been done before. And having a network vouch for you is also important, and so LinkedIn can be a good tool for that, where people can see that who you are associated with, because we are judged by the company we keep, and if we're associated with good quality people, and they have nice things to say about us, then we get a benefit of a halo effect from that. And also we want to be findable, so if people are looking for us, then they can actually find us. So if you look at trust overall, chemistry is important, and most of us are reasonably good in that area. If we were really obnoxious, then we probably wouldn't have taken the time to come here. So this is not really enough to differentiate us, right? Because the chemistry is generally pretty good. Credentials, again, it's required. So for instance, if you're doing video editing, there's certain skills that you would need to have, and as a customer, they may have difficulty gauging how one person's skills differ from another. They just expect a certain basic level of skills. So the congruence is the element that really makes the difference, because the other two are essentially givens. And trust depends a lot on this particular element. These days, your brand isn't what you say it is when you're networking and talking to people. It's what people discover it to be when they do a web search, in many cases. And so a key question that arises is, if you were to type your name or your company name into a search engine, as people might do, then what shows up? And is what shows up what you want to have show up? Another thing is email. Having an email address at your own domain is, what, $10, $12 a year? And still, I see, especially freelancers, so many of them are using things like Gmail, etc. So, okay, you're in business, you're supposed to be established, supposed to be good, but you can't afford a dollar a month to have a real email address? It just seems a little suspect. Now, you can use something like Google Apps, it's free. Right? So you can have Gmail working in the background for you, but the email could be coming directly to a different address. So for instance, I have an email address which is ps@marketingactuary.com. So that's costing me my $10 US a year from Google, but it all looks like a real email address to people. Behind the scenes, it's Gmail. So little things like that can affect the perception. So nice business card, and then the email address is Gmail, or Hotmail or something like that, or Rogers. And some of these companies we don't even like. You don't find many people who say that they love the phone company or the cable company, yet every time you're sending an email, you're advertising them, you're associating your brand with their brand. Little things like that may make a difference. Something else that might be worthwhile is to reveal things that your competitors are taking pains to conceal. And this has to do with you being an advocate, where you are showing that you are on the side of your clients rather than the industry. And so things you might consider doing, because if you're thinking of hiring someone, don't you want to know what the price is? Right? But you will rarely find freelancers saying what the price is. Now there could be, say, here is a typical project, this is roughly what it costs, or a chart per hour, etc. But that's something that could be helpful. There is generally fine print in any business. You could help people understand what the implications of that are. You could tell them how to select you. So for instance, if you're a writer, well, everyone thinks they can write. I think I can write. But there would be different levels of writing. And for someone who thinks they can do it themselves, how do you explain to them that if you do it yourself, there are some consequences? Right? And so you can explain that to them. Another strategy is to tell people how they can do it themselves. I was talking to someone the other day, and he does business plans, but a lot of his clients think that they can do their own business plans. So I told him if he explained how to actually do a business plan, the people that would do their own will still do that. But other people will say that, wow, I had no idea there's so much involved. Because on the surface, everything looks trivial. There's probably some Excel template that you can download for free that'll do a business plan. But maybe there's a little more to it. And so things like this may help you show that you are different than other freelancers. And you need to see what makes sense in your own situation. So we looked at these two key words. So a fact is a verifiable truth, and a demonstration is a display of proof. And there's an ideal place to show both of these things. That's free. And the most basic place is LinkedIn. And it looks like everyone is already on LinkedIn. So you can certainly use other platforms also, because depending on what you're doing, you may find that more of your prospects are on Facebook or Pinterest or other places. But LinkedIn is a very important place too. And what you want to do here is not put your boring resume that no one really wants to read, but make it interesting. So it's more of a marketing profile. In particular, in your profile at the top, you can write a summary. And that can be interesting and engaging to encourage people to read the rest. That's something that's good. So in terms of verifiable truths, on LinkedIn, you essentially have your resume. You've got testimonials. Right? So those are things that give signs that, okay, this is someone who is good at what they do, which is what you would expect to see. And another part are the displays of proof. So this is something that's current. So the resume part, that's static. It's really boring. When I did mine, it took me 2 or 3 months because it was just so dull, right? You have to go through all these steps to complete your profile to 100%. But once you do it, you're done, right? And it's all about you. So it's not the worst thing in the world to write about. But that's static. Well, okay, if you're boring like me, then maybe it is. But that's where you want to make it more of a marketing profile, make it interesting. And if you don't know how to do that, then maybe get help from someone who knows how to write. But that's static. So in terms of things that are dynamic, the displays of current proof, this is where you can post your status updates. So whenever you do a status update, your entire network is reminded of you. It's essentially free advertising. In my case, I look for one update per day on average. In your case, maybe you want to do a couple of weeks, so maybe on Tuesdays or Thursdays or something. But it doesn't take a lot of time, and a good update is not I'm standing in front of a group of people, my knees are shaking, and I'm telling them about trust. It would be perhaps a link to an article, something that would be of interest to that group. And also participating in groups is a good place. And here, you don't want to participate in groups that your competitors are in. You want to participate in groups where your prospects are. Right? There's no point me telling other people how great I am in the insurance world, right? Because they would never be clients. But if I'm in groups that have small business owners, etc., then that could be a better choice. So as a bare minimum, LinkedIn is a great tool for you to use, and it's all free. Now, with trust, you need a steady supply of fuel. It's like a hot air balloon. And if you stop doing things, then your balloon doesn't stay afloat for long. And it's also pretty tough to fake. So there are two stages in establishing trust. The first is that you can be a parrot. And what this means is that you repeat things that others have said. So for instance, you're a curator. You've come across an interesting article, and you share that with your network. So then your network knows that here is someone who is looking out for us. They keep us up to date about what's going on in their industry, things that can help us. Now, that's not bad to do, but another part, and this is really important for freelancers, is to be a pundit. So now you become an authority. You demonstrate that you really know your stuff. You're not simply passing on things that others have created. You're showing your own thought leadership. That takes a little more work. So in curating, and this is my only slide with bullet points, so I thought that I should at least have one so that you could say, well, I still know how to use them. But sharing links is a really good idea, and you can also create your own. And you pick whatever network is good for you, and you want to experiment. For instance, in my case, I'm in the business-to-business world, so I don't use Facebook very much. In what you're doing, maybe Facebook would be a better choice. In my case, LinkedIn ends up being a really key tool. And I'll show you a link later on that has a copy of this presentation, so that way you can get all the slides and additional links to other articles. And because curation is easy to do, it's not worth very much. But it's still a good thing to do. If you want to be a professional, then creating content is really good. If you like talking, then you can record your voice, and now you have a podcast. If you like showing things, then you can create video, and you can put them on YouTube, and that's free. If you like writing, then you can blog. There'll be one of these mediums, or media, which is a better fit for you. And if you can create one, then you can create the others. The best one is video, because that's the most persuasive. And if you have video, then what you can do is take the soundtrack, and now that's a podcast. You can transcribe it, and now you have a blog post. But if you have one, then you can create the other ones from that. And the key here is to show consistent, persistent generosity, a terminology from Seth Godin. So people start to realize that they can rely on you. Now, in my case, I think blogging is the most effective tool. And that's because it's the easiest to create. You can use any type of equipment, and you don't have to have anything fancy. It could be your phone, it could be your tablet, it could be your computer. It's very easy to find. Google is best at indexing text still. They're trying to do things with images and video, etc., but you can't beat text in terms of showing up. And it's also very easy to consume. You don't need headphones. You can be anywhere. All you need is a device that's able to show text. But you may find that other things are more effective in your world. Now, one of the things that Seth says is that most people are average, right? Because that's what average means. And what we want to do is get out of the commodity area by being seen as the best in the world, which ties in with us finding a niche that we want to be known in. And this is tough for freelancers. It also means saying no to things, because we're defined in large part by what we refuse to do. And if we say that we'll do everything, so say we take photographs, well, is that weddings? Is it business photography? Is it like, there'd be a whole range. Is it product photography? And maybe there's a tendency to do all of it, but maybe there's more advantages to just doing one and doing it well. But when it comes to building trust, the things we're looking at, say sharing content, etc., is pretty easy to do in the beginning. There's really no learning curve. You can start posting updates with no effort. The real challenge is continuing with it. And what happens is, if you stop, and this is really where the benefits arise, because most people will quit. And then if you stop doing things, so you've got your past history, you're showing that you're really great, but you're not doing things on an ongoing basis, then you start sliding down. And it's really hard to fool anyone, right? Because they can see that, oh, this person started a blog, but they haven't had a post in 3 months or a year. And maybe they're good at what they do, but they're not really good at keeping promises. Because these types of things are public commitments. And the real benefits occur as you stick with them, because most people won't. So just to give you an idea of some of the things that I've done, and anyone could do the same sorts of things, is I started with blogging. So back in 2007, my job was to help advisors make more money. And I saw that trust was a big issue. I thought that instead of being proprietary about what they knew, if they just started sharing their ideas, then they could start standing out from their competitors. And I knew that I needed to show them how, so it wasn't just idle talk. And so I started doing that, and now I've got over 500 posts, which is 250,000 words. But it all started off with just a few hundred words. In the beginning, 5 posts, 10 posts, 50 posts, doesn't really mean much. But 500, that shows something. And some of them have to be reasonably good. Or even if they're all lousy, it shows that this person is willing to stick with things. And that's a good sign. And then it's important that your words, because I have no training in writing, but it's important that your words sound good to the ear. And a way to do that is to just read things aloud. And I thought, why don't I just record my voice, which is me just reading my podcast, sorry, reading my blog post, and then I had a podcast. So you start doing that, and then you have another way for people to reach you. And I have a few podcasts that have over 1,000 people who have listened to them. A lot of them are a lot less. But at the same time, it costs me virtually nothing to do that. But the fact is, when you do those things, you get better at speaking. So there's no downside there. And you also get better at the editing. And then by just doing these simple sorts of things, I was interviewed by the Toronto Star. That was last year. And then I've also been interviewed in the Globe and Mail and various other niche publications, which are well suited to the types of clients I'm looking for. And one of the things I wanted to do for ages was to speak at this conference. And the very first year, Ted Rogers spoke, and last year his son. And last year I got invited. And again, it was just because of me using some of these little tools of building trust and just sticking with them for a while. And then I guess the highlight is last year I got nominated for a Business Excellence Award from the Toronto Board of Trade. So they had 49 nominees in 8 categories, and I was the only one from the financial sector. And again, why is that? It's just because I'm doing some basic things that other people could easily do also, but they chose either to not do them or to start and then quit. Now is when we'll have our discussion. So, what? It's not... Okay, I'm glad you're laughing. Because the real benefits come from when we share our thoughts. So what are your thoughts on trust or freelancing? Or
do people trust the LinkedIn recommendations, or are they like those sort of John Wayne ads, or whatever, like everyone has one or two?
I don't think the LinkedIn recommendations really prove much, but If you don't have them, it shows something.
Right.
And there are some people who will have like 40, 50 recommendations. So I don't know if they pay people or what they do. It just seems crazy. But then you'll look at them and you'll see that they haven't given any recommendations. So they don't have a kind word to say to anyone else, about anyone else. So what I'd like to see is people who have received at least 3 recommendations, like relevant ones, so not that we both worked at the same company and we think we're great, but someone who has hired you for the kind of service you're trying to provide. But I'm more interested in seeing how many recommendations the person has given. So if they received 3, I'd like to see that they've given at least 5. Because that shows that they are willing to help other people. They're showing signs of generosity. Other people may look at it in different ways. So I don't think the recommendations prove much, but the lack of recommendations is pretty telling. Yes.
Also with the recommendations, does it get to have updated ones? I mean, if you have a recommendation from 2008 and then there's nothing for 2 years or 3 years, then when people start getting suspect of, are you keeping up? Are you still good at what you do?
Well,
so
what do you think?
Well, I'm thinking, you know, they should be up to date as much as possible. Like, you don't need like 6 in a year, but maybe 1 or 2 every year and try and add to it.
Yeah, so having the one from 2008 is great. It showed that the person was doing good work at that time. But the client wants to hire you today in 2012. And maybe a lot of things have changed in that time. And if you have current recommendations, that helps. But it may be that you're in a sector where privacy is a big concern. You can't say what your clients cannot identify themselves because you're doing certain kinds of work. That's where the current displays of proof would be good. So if you show that you're writing in your area of expertise, blogging or video, whatever it happens to be, then it'll show that this person is still around, because some websites look like they're ghost websites. They look great, but it doesn't look like anything has changed in the last 5 years. And so having ongoing information can be a way to substitute for a recommendation. But yeah, if there's nothing current, then that does raise doubts.
What about intuition? Have you ever done stuff on intuition?
What do you mean by that?
Well, last year, I think this was last spring or summer, I had this idea I wanted to do some speech writing, right?
Okay.
Because I've always wanted to do that, but I didn't really have much experience. But through talking to a few people, somebody had left a position at a company and said there's going to be a gap. But I wasn't interested in, she had a full-time job, but I was not interested in working anywhere full-time. So I kind of went in and sort of proposed this to the communications manager, who kind of looked at me and just basically said, what experience do you have? Mm-hmm. And I went, none really. However, well, what I proposed was that they give me something low profile to write, and if they don't like it, then they'll pay me and I'll be on my way. And that was in November. So I'm still doing it.
Okay.
So every once in a while, if you really strongly feel that you have the skill to do something, even if you haven't done it before, but you have other skills that have led up to that, and you know that you can put out, like, bring it together to do that, I think it's worth giving it a shot.
Yeah, we generally have a lot more capabilities than we show. The question is, what are you seen as the specialist in? Mm-hmm. Now, if it's tying in with, because you're a writer, I believe. Okay, so it does tie in with your writing skills, so it's not a totally big leap from what you're doing. But for other people, it may be more of a jump. And so there needs to be some connection. So for instance, I do presentations. So I could probably do a presentation on how to do presentations. Right? It wouldn't be an obvious thing because I don't have training in that. But the fact that I have done that means that I could. But then, do I want to be known as someone who teaches people how to do presentations? Mm-hmm. Right. So I decided that I wanted to be associated with a word, and that word is trust. Right? Because you can't say, hey, trust me, I'm really trustworthy, right? You can't do any of that. But if you talk about trust, then the implication is that you are probably doing things to live up to that trust.
Don't trust a word this guy says.
Rob, thanks for showing up.
I said, I don't trust him.
But you're still here to learn.
I just came to warn everybody.
Okay, well, it's good that you came towards the end rather than the beginning.
What did I miss?
He's already convinced us to trust him, so we're too late.
Yes, you gotcha. Yeah, too late.
If you want to hear more about trust after you get the relationship, I'm giving a presentation at 12.
Why should we trust you?
Because I trust him.
That's how it works.
So there are different things that may cause people to trust one another. Other questions that people have? Yes.
Have you kind of broken down how much chemistry plays, how much credentials? Like, is it like a 33% split, or is the chemistry more important?
Well, I'm an actuary, so I could make up numbers very easily. The chemistry, I mean, that's the first impression, right? And so if that's not... So all of them matter, but the chemistry is probably the first thing, right? So for whatever reason...
Don't let me interrupt.
You're not taking a photo of me.
Yeah. I want the whole crowd and you. I want your head right here at the crowd. But I don't want you to... I'm sorry to interrupt.
Is it okay if I continue?
Yes.
Sorry. Wow, it's good he came later, isn't it?
Sorry.
Yes. No, you can go ahead. It helps in developing speaking skills to have random things going on. If the chemistry isn't there, then the rest is lost.
Right?
Because we generally have substitutes. Clients feel they have substitutes. And if for whatever reason they don't like you, then they probably won't explore further.
Is there a way to work on that, the chemistry part? I mean, like you mentioned Toastmasters, I guess, or something.
Yeah, well, the first thing would be maybe to get feedback from other people, because it's very hard for us to see how we come across. To others, we think we're really great, but maybe talk to some people that you trust and say, well, what do you think of me? Like, what would you suggest I change? And be open, because sometimes the things are not pleasant. Because we, as I was saying earlier, we can generally fix up other people's lives, but we think our own lives are pretty good. So that could be a good way of starting. So that's really the entry point. So if you think of Malcolm Gladwell's books, for instance, that would be Blink, like the first impressions, and they can be fairly accurate, right? Because we have all these different senses. So if they like you, then that's basically the first point. And then they have to feel that you can do the work. So either from credentials or past experience or a combination. So, but there are so many other people who would be similar from a client's point of view that those two things wouldn't really matter. It's not like hiring someone in a job interview. Like, everyone will present themselves in a particular way, but is that how they really are? Maybe not. And that's where the congruence really comes in, because that shows that you are walking your walk. You've got evidence on an ongoing basis that you really are what you say. And anyone can build congruence, but most people don't bother because maybe they're too busy or they don't understand or whatever. And so that becomes the way that you can set yourself apart, because the other two are essential, but they're taken for granted. Yes?
Since trust is about building a relationship with people, how did you build a relationship with people that were reading your blog?
Well, I haven't had situations where people will read a blog post and say, well, what's your mailing address? I'd like to send you money. I've used it in conjunction with other things. So normally I'll meet people somewhere, and then we'll be talking about something, and maybe I have a blog post that's related to that, and I'll send that to them. Or they'll do a web search. Someone was telling me recently that I'd known her for a number of months, and then she did a web search and she went to my blog, etc. And she was saying that she had really low expectations. Because, like, freelancer, like, you wouldn't expect that much. And I exceeded those low expectations. Right? And so then, confounding expectations or exceeding them is better than setting really high expectations. So I leave a lot of these things more in the background. And the idea is that I want someone to go and search them out. In the early days, Google had a very interesting strategy. The other companies like Yahoo, etc., were spending big dollars on TV ads, etc., billboards. And Google didn't do any of that. And Sergey Brin was saying that he would rather that you discover Google tomorrow than today, because tomorrow they would be a little bit better than today. So if I tell you, I've tried this new search engine called Google, why don't you check it out? Well, maybe a week goes by before you get to it. So now it's 7 days of improvement. So when you go to it, you say, well, wow, this is pretty good. But it's actually a better version than what I saw. And then you tell someone else. And so rather than having everyone come at the same time and be disappointed, because if you try Yahoo and you say, well, hey, it's no big deal, then what's the reason for coming back? And so it's a strategy along those lines. I don't know if that really helps.
Every startup, they always tend to ask the CEO, what's your site? He'll always say, oh, check it out next Monday. You know, because there's always something in the works, right?
Sure.
Every startup.
Yeah. Okay, so I'll be around in case there are other questions. So we'll just go to the wrap-up now so that we can keep things on schedule. So in terms of the summary, this is something that Seth just wrote yesterday. Just think about this, that if you just took 10 minutes, because we can generally find 10 minutes in the day, right? And you did something that was visible online, then what you'd be doing is you'd be building your digital tapestry. And in the beginning, there wouldn't be much to see. It would look very crude. But then as you kept adding things to it, and this takes time, it takes patience, then eventually you'll have something that is quite remarkable. And it's hard to believe that this can arise from that, but it can. And part of this is just showing courage, because that's another way of building trust. And a lot of us are afraid about our privacy. We don't want people to know about us. We don't want to tell how we do things because then our competitors would find out. Don't worry so much about your competitors. Worry about the potential clients who haven't heard of you and are looking for someone with similar services. And so when you look at all of this, then trust is really important. And the key thing to remember that at the heart of trust is you.
That's
isn't that
clever? I
was
hoping you'd do that.
Well, okay, well, I did. So thanks for attending the session. I will be around. If you have questions, then I'd be glad to help you with them. Thanks.
Thank you.
Come on, can I have a picture of you? Can you come just stand right here so I get this in the background and these four people will look like a big crowd?
Oh, okay. You'll make it look like they're
about to stand right there.
Oh, okay. And I won't look too short then either.
Yes, it'll be really good.
I'll look down. Really okay, good. Yeah, thanks for kneeling down.
Sure, thank you.
Hi, Sharon.
Good one.
Hey, thanks.
You know, I would add that my friend, he teaches film class, and he says the way he gets his students' trust is they come in on the first day, and he says, here are all the mistakes that I made when I was shooting my feature film. Don't make these same mistakes. And so it's a self-deprecating approach, because everyone's going to, they have this natural inclination, like, hate the teacher, especially in film class, where there's so many egos. And he goes in and says, look, I screwed up. I had a big chance, and this is the piece of crap that I made. Don't make a piece of crap like this. And all the kids immediately love him, and still do. He's one of the best teachers at Humber Film Class, Andrew.
Yeah, because people get concerned about mistakes. Now, if you've only done a few things that people can see, and one of them was bad, then it sticks out.
Yeah.
But if you keep doing things, then people will say, well, okay, that mistake was an outlier. Those comments were just out of line. That's not how the person really is. And so people, like, we're generally forgiving, right? That's just our nature. And the fact that we've made a few mistakes is not that big a deal. And if we will actually acknowledge those mistakes, then that's even more powerful, because criticism, as we were looking at earlier, is a really big fear that people have.
Okay.
Looks like you have a question or a comment?
He was stretching.
Oh, okay.
I won a job once by going onto a Blogspot blog and complaining bitterly about the person on his comment form. And then he came back and said, you're absolutely right. Everything you've said is exactly right. Perhaps you can help me. And I immediately went, well, of course I can help you.
That's what I do.
Yeah. And then, it was only a $500 job, this guy in Hamilton. I'll tell you what did it, is I was watching CHCH News, and he came on and was talking about social media. So, and this is back when I thought I was the god of social media, years ago, okay? And And so I got on, immediately went on to his blog, and I found it was a Blogspot blog. And if there's anything I despise more, I don't know what it is. So I I wrote a disparaging comment and said, here you are, the king of social media, and you have a Blogspot blog. He said, perhaps you can help me. And I said, well, we can get you over to WordPress right away.
Then he has a WordPress blog.
No, okay. He has his own.com now for his company. I don't actually hate Blogspots as much as I did. I used to really hate them. Now I see them, they're really relevant again. And did you notice that all the Blogspot blogs have now changed to your .country, whatever it is? Like, I had a .com and it was PageRank 4, and now it's a .ca, PageRank 0.
Wait a second, so you're using a Blogspot blog?
My very favorite blog is a Blogspot blog, and I dare not move it. It's my very favorite one of all of them, the one I love the most, closest to my heart.
Actually, all of my blogs are Blogspot, and the reason I did that is that there's less that you can do with Blogspot.
Yeah.
I figure with WordPress, you're spending all this time with plugins and tweaking, etc. And it's important to have Google love you. If you're using their products, you'd figure that in their algorithms, it can't hurt you.
Agreed. Anyway, though, I'm always surprised at how high those Blogspot blogs rank, and I think it's because in the Google algorithm, there's a certain trust factor. There's a certain, you know, when they know, they have more information in it. It's a richer source, and they can kind of dial into it better. However, it's a fact. On a Blogspot blog, you cannot enter alt text on your pictures, unless there's a new plugin I don't know about. You cannot do a lot of things. You can't even add a header. On the visual toolbar in Blogspot blog, there's no H1, H2, H3 button to add a header. You have to go into HTML and add the headers in HTML.
Or you can use Windows Live Writer, which is free. And it has all the headings, and it has the alt text, etc. You just use it on your desktop.
And then you,
and then you publish from that.
So Windows Live Writer.
Yeah, it's part of the Windows. It's part of Windows Live Essentials. It's free. And it's a pretty good tool for writing blogs. It tells you your word count, which is something else that's important for people to know when they're writing. But you're raising an interesting point. So if in your area of expertise, if you see people who could use your services, then maybe you do make suggestions to them, like unsolicited ideas that, hey, I was looking at your video or this or that, and you might want to consider such and such. And you've already established your expertise by showing them something that can be improved, and that can increase the chances of them hiring you.
It's true. I think anytime you make a comment, you're doing a good thing. Anytime you leave a comment somewhere, I think you're helping that person out because they get some satisfaction, some gratification. Oh, someone read this. And I think that really goes a long way to building a relationship.
And also, it shows courage because you're going on the record saying something that you're willing to stand behind that other people may not agree. For instance, there was I get emails from Ted, and they were saying there was this really amazing video for young people to see about careers and how, well, careers would be different in the future. It was a professor from the University of Waterloo, so I went and I looked at that video, and I didn't think it was very good. And other people, like there are thousands of people who say they like it. And so my comment was that I thought there were several things that were that I thought could be improved. For instance, this person was telling young people about basically follow your passions. Right? So basically, you need to know what your passion is and follow it. And I'm thinking, and I didn't write this, but okay, so your passion was to become an economics professor? Like, so when you were at this stage yourself, what was your passion? It's great to say things now, but in many cases, in some cases, we will discover our passions over time. And we do need to pay off our student loans, we need jobs, etc. So it's great to be following a passion, but that doesn't help with the student loans. And so I thought there were some points there that could be made, so I made a comment there.
And
then someone made a comment that basically wasn't very kind about my comment, but at least I took a stand.
Yeah.
And as you start doing these things, I mean, so someone who, because part of the strategy is to polarize people. You want people to either like you more or like you less. And that's part of being trust. Part of being trusted, because you're taking a stance, and doing that in public is an ideal place, because then people can judge for themselves, hey, are you the person I like, or are you not, etc.
Promod, they're queuing up the door up there.
Okay.
I can see them all. They're too scared to open the door.
Is there another session?
Yes. think so.
Yeah. And I'll tell you what, wherever the next session is, buddy, I'm going to sit right beside you.
Yeah. Oh, my goodness.
I'd like to hear more about polarizing, because that, as a girl, that's just terrifying. The idea of people not liking me, like, I'm just hung up on being liked, and I think a lot of women like that. But I'm thinking about a lot about women in business, because I'm taking a course right now, so.
But you're not doing it in a way to be offensive.
No, but if you ever take a stand on anything, someone's going to disagree with you. And I don't know, we're kind of socialized to not ever.
So an easy way to start then is maybe just start leaving comments on other people's blogs. Start doing it anonymously. And you'll see that nothing bad happens.
Yeah.
But if people don't know what you stand for.
You need to kind of try it out a little bit. That's a good advice, because the thought of being disagreed with or insulted.
But you want that. Because if you look at it really, like people who people hate, like the people who love also. Like say Howard Stern, some people think he's great.
Yeah.
Got no time.
But I've spent 36 years flying under the radar because I wanted everyone to like me, and then I finally was like, God, if everyone likes you, you're so boring that there's going to be someone who hates you for being boring. So you're
being average, and you'd rather have a fewer number of people like you more.
Yeah, exactly.